Good going for the equity markets today, although the action is on the bond side. Pradeep is here to tell us what's making stocks move today and by how much. Pradeep.
So actually, for the last 3 days, I've been stuck with just one word, that is volatility. And that is what we had expected. But today's volatility is rather induced, I would say, by RBI, because yesterday we had a warning coming from RBI saying we'll not help yield stabilize. So there was a sell-off, banks fell, and then NBFCs corrected. And now today you have this RBI dividend, which has supported apparently government to cut on the borrowing. So there's a spike in PSU banks. I think that is where a lot of traders got trapped, because in the morning what happened, technically significant 200 DMA was also breached on PSU bank index, and there was some short buildup, and then suddenly you got this update. So those shorts got covered. So PSU banks are leading, followed by the other banks. Even private sector banks have rallied. Then you have some support coming in from IT that continues for second or third day in a row, again supported by the orders that TCS has received. And that is how the mood has changed. But if you look at mid-cap and small-cap space, market is not really that buoyant. If you look at the total movement in Nifty from day's low of almost 10,665 or so, we have recovered 75 points. But if you look at the movement in mid-cap and small-cap, maybe the mood is not that bullish. There is still some pressure there. There are certain pockets, like, for example, you can look at Urban Offshore, which was tracking crude, and there is some weakness in crude, so that is sold off. MCX came out with bad numbers. And then you have several high beta names which are still stuck. GVK Power, the stock that I mentioned yesterday, is again locked at lower circuit today. So some of these stocks that, kind of tell you a feel that the bull run is intact till the time they keep moving up. And once they start hitting lower circuit, I think that's a warning sign. So decent recovery. There is possibly a reason for this recovery, but I think traders are not yet as confident as they were, 3 or 4 days back.
All right, Pradeep, thanks so much for that. Some volatility coming into the equity markets induced by what's been happening in the bond markets, and that is the big story today. Pull up the 10-year bond yield chart if you can, and that will help you understand what's been going on since the morning. The market opened, then you had a tweet go out from the DEA secretary saying that they are cutting their additional borrowing from the planned 50,000 crore to now 20,000 crore. Yields fell as much as 15 basis points at one point in the day. Then they started to inch up higher. Now Bloomberg News is reporting that borrowing cut may have come on the back of a higher RBI dividend. Let's first go across to Karthik Goyal for the latest on the news that's developing. Karthik, sources are telling Bloomberg News that this is an RBI dividend related borrowing cut.
Yeah, that's true. That seems to be the case right now, but the bond markets clearly are going through a roller coaster ride. After a massive sell-off, we are seeing a rally today. And today's move clearly has come on the back of the government cutting down its additional borrowing program, and which seems to be backed by the RBI agreeing to give higher dividend to the government, which is much needed given the government's very fledgling revenue situation coming on the back of still disruptions from the GST.
So it's important that we caveat this. The report actually says the government considered a case for higher dividend from the central bank to decide on lowering its estimate. So we really don't know where this is coming from. But let's find out what the market has taken this as.
And I think, Karthik, sure. Thanks so much for that. But before we go on, we need to pull up the chart of the borrowings, over a five-year period.
Yeah.
The reason I'm saying that is because, people in the market today have been saying that there is, an immediate news issue, but there is also a credibility issue. So if you look at this chart, it was firstly for the first time in 6 years that you had seen the government increase borrowings by a substantial amount within the course of the fiscal year. And that last line where you see that red bar, so essentially they went to 6.3 with the additional 50,000 crore borrowing, and now they've come off to about 6 lakh crore for the full year, still higher than the budgeted target, but yes, lower than what they had earlier revised it to.
Let's get in, Vivek Rajpal. Vivek, thank you so much for joining us on Bloomberg Quint. What have you made of the developments of the day? It's been quite a bit of a roller coaster ride for the bond markets. One, the message from the government of reducing the borrowing. The second, that perhaps it could be because of support coming in from the RBI.
Right. To put things in the context, actually bond markets became nervous when government announced additional borrowing of INR 500 billion towards late December. And we observed yield spike right after that. And since then, markets have been more or less jittery. Actually, markets' initial expectation was always something like INR 300 billion of extra borrowing or so. So today's news that they have cut additional borrowing from 500 billion to INR 200 billion provides some relief to the bond markets. Having said that, I think it's still a tactical relief. For a strategic relief or for really this momentum on bond yields higher, going higher, or let me put it this way, for a meaningful rally, I think we need some market-friendly outcome from the budget.
Okay. So, Vivek, just to push that point a little further, does this reduce the supply-side pressure on the market, one? And what would those favorable measures that you would anticipate from the budget?
Right. So, I think, does it reduce the supply pressure? Marginally. What happened was in late December, government cancelled one auction, so they were anyways running behind by INR 150 billion lower than their estimates. And today's news that they will cut additional borrowing from 500 to 200 means another that a reduction of one auction of INR 150 billion. So there is still a supply pressure, but I would say market will expect one auction less than what initially envisaged. So it's a marginal reduction of supply pressure.
Right. Vivek, if I can just interrupt you for a minute, you know, on the supply thing, I was speaking to, one of your colleagues here in the bond market locally, and they said that if you see this borrowing getting replaced with T-bill borrowing, the market would be okay with that. See, we just know the headline number. We don't know what they are doing within that. Are they taking those dated securities borrowings and moving them to T-bill borrowings? Is that relevant to you?
I think that's relevant, but the point that I was coming to was that relative to budget, they are anyways borrowing extra in T-bill, extra through T-bill borrowing. So though INR 500 billion extra borrowing through dated securities was the headline number, if you really compare the numbers with the budget, the numbers are close to something like INR 700 billion or so. Now, if you are telling me that cutting, they will further reduce the borrowing and further shift the additional borrowing to T-bill, yes, it's always easier to absorb supply in the T-bills versus dated securities because it doesn't add duration to the market. So that should be, if something like that happens, that will be additional relief. But note that these are tactical marginal reliefs. The key thing to watch will be what will be the fiscal deficit going ahead. For FY18, I think most of the supply, we now know how much is the supply pressure, but most importantly, what will be the fiscal deficit target for FY19 is something that bond markets will be keenly focusing on.
All right, Vivek, thanks so much for joining us with that quick take. That's Vivek Rajpal of Nomura with what's been happening in the bond markets this morning. Let's get a bigger picture on this because, this is not just a story about today. This is a story about the year, perhaps about the fiscal credibility of the government. And, if the RBI comes in with an additional dividend, then also an issue about the RBI's credibility. Ananth Narayan, professor at SP Jain Institute of Management, a veteran of the Indian debt markets, is joining us here. Ananth, thanks so much for stepping by. I know it was a rushed interview request to you, so thanks for accommodating us. Anand, I want to put to you the bigger question. I mean, we've talked about today's movements. You got the 50,000 crore just a fortnight back. Now they're saying it's going to be, 20,000 crore. Then a government, official without being named says it could be premised because of a higher RBI dividend. A little bit of mismanagement in all of this, right, over the course of the year from the government's end?
Yeah, Ira, afternoon, first of all. And you're right, the market won't be happy with this confusion. And a lot of the volatility we've seen over the last 20 days since we first heard that the government is going to borrow 50,000 crores more to today could have been avoided. Having said that, one does have some sympathy for the government as well. This isn't an easy year for making projections on revenues, principally because we have the GST implementation going on. And I'm not sure even now if the government is completely clear about how the full year collections are going to look like. Add to that the fact that oil prices have gone up, the fact that they've had to release and give some leeway on the excise duty for oil. You know, there are lots of moving parts in respect of this year's accounting, and therefore all of this confusion. But I think the broader issue remains that a lot of the macro tailwinds that we had and enjoyed over the last 3-4 years, unfortunately, seem to be going away. The biggest one being oil prices. You know, the last couple of fiscal years, oil averaged about $50 a barrel on Brent. Today, it's at close to 70. We import about 1.2 billion barrels every year. So every $10 is about $12 billion of additional current account deficit and inflation or fiscal deficit, one of the two. That's a big one. Second, we also know that there's, you know, this being a budget for the election year, we will see a lot of spending going through, and therefore the fiscal question can come through all over again. And lastly, the global environment is looking very, very questionable. You know, we're now talking about the European Central Bank removing accommodation. We know that there is stuff happening in the US as well. 3 rate hikes are pretty much penciled in for this year. And we also have the chaos of, you know, possible shutdown in the US looming across. So the global environment isn't necessarily stable as well. So all these put together does make for difficult budget math, difficult uncertainties on the inflation front, on the monetary policy front, and therefore on all our markets, both on fixed income as well as currency.
Ananth, if this is, you know, if the cut in additional borrowing has come on the back of, you know, the RBI putting in an additional dividend, what would your view be? Again, would you give some leeway based on the conditions? Would you then question whether the RBI is sort of, you know, giving in to the government's demands and it should not? How would you view that if it happens? Because so far it's only source-based information coming in from the finance ministry.
We'll have to wait for the information to come and get confirmed, Ira. But on the face of it, if the RBI didn't think that dividend was due earlier and is now changing its track, obviously questions will be asked, and I think legitimate questions need to be asked. Having said that, you know, the market always expected a much lower increased borrowing number to come through from the government. You know, on 27th of December, when the 50,000 crore was announced, the market had geared for more or less 25,000 crores or so. And the reason for that was, one, we thought that the small savings schemes would garner a lot more of money. In fact, I understand that till November, small savings have already gathered as much has been budgeted for the whole year, about 1 lakh crore rupees. So it didn't think that we'd have to do all of the, you know, fiscal deficit shortfall through actual borrowing by the government. In terms of leeway for this year, look, this is a transitional year. GST is known to cause revenue issues in the first year in whichever country it's implemented, and India is no exception. I do think that next year, once the steering issues are behind us, we will see a big fillip to GST revenue collections. I think that will happen. So to that extent, having some leeway in this year is fine. But we have to be very careful that the leeway for the next year's budget is not used for populist measures and for doles. You know, we can easily fall into the trap that this is an exception and therefore, you know, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4% of slippage on fiscal deficit isn't bad. It's for the right reason. We've seen this movie before, Ira, you know, in 2009, 10, 11, 12, when we departed from the FRBM and spent big with the hopes of reviving the economy or giving it a fillip. We know how that movie ended. I'm not a fan of the government picking up big infrastructure tabs. There are better ways of making sure savings goes into infrastructure and investments. You know, look at the way, for instance, the Golden Quadrilateral was managed in the early 2000s in the first NDA government. I think that is a picture-perfect example to use. Use public-private partnerships, use a financially sustainable model to make sure that money comes in from the market and goes into infrastructure, rather than necessarily loosening the fiscal strings.
Ananth, hi, this is Harsha joining in the conversation as well. You know, one of the comments that came today after the borrowing cut was announced was saying that even if this borrowing cut hadn't happened, you know, the fiscal deficit target is not going to be met. That's one of the ones I heard somebody say that today. given the sort of the environment and the factors that you've painted, rising oil prices, all the benefits of the last 3 years is all discounted today. What to your mind are the big risks, and what would be priority for the finance minister in the budget making exercise?
Well, there are plenty of risks, Harsha. So the first risk is uncertainty, right? As I mentioned, I'm not sure on February 1st when the finance minister presents his budget, whether he'll have a full picture of how GST numbers will look like for this fiscal itself.
Correct.
Typically in March, we see big excise collections in the past, right? And I'm not sure how GST is going to pan out in March. Normally we see twice the a monthly target coming through in 1 month in March. So unfortunately, he'll be playing in the blind on this year's budget numbers alone. Now, in addition, of course, all the factors that we mentioned earlier, the fact that commodity prices are looking very iffy, none of us expected oil to be at 70. All the stories about shale gas and about renewable energy aren't really playing out as we expected. If oil goes up to 80, that causes a massive amount of problem both on inflation and on the fisc and on current account deficit as well. The second big risk, which I think we have to worry about, is the foreign exchange markets. While things are looking absolutely fine and RBI's reserves at $411 billion are at all-time highs, the reality is a lot of these reserves have been built up based on carry positions, including FPI in debt, mm-hmm. including NRI, NRE in deposits, and exporters selling forward dollars. Okay. The actual core flows are now turning negative. Mm-hmm. With current account, we'll have a current account deficit this fiscal, which is the highest in the last 5 years. Mm. It'll be in the region of $45 to $50 billion. So it's no longer a case where the core flows are positive. If we have monthly core outflows, then we need something additional to come in, either FPI and equity or debt, just to keep the balance. So if that turns, you could see a lot of pent up, built up positions also turn the other way around. So in short, Harsha, we've enjoyed macro tailwinds in the last few years. And the real risk is that just when the government needs some spending to go through for an election budget, you could have macro tailwinds turning into macro headwinds, both on the external environment, on commodities, and on inflation and domestic points. I think the positive side to all this, it's not all doom and gloom. The domestic economy seems to be recovering. We saw the PMIs for December, they were pretty robust. We saw the IIP numbers which came out. Yes, there's a base effect, but still it wasn't bad reading at all. It's possible that the GST collections for December are up as well. Maybe that's one of the reasons why the borrowing number has come down. So hopefully the groundswell of recovery that we all expected and we know will come through because of the teething issues of GST going behind us, hopefully that will kind of keep the momentum going through and make up for some of these macro headwinds. Right. But all in all, it's not a good time for the finance minister, and I don't envy his shoes really at this point in time.
Okay, Anand, I have one last question, not linked to today's events or the borrowing in particular, but I suspect you had a chance to read or at least hear about Viral Acharya's speech at the FIMDA dinner on Monday. He really took bond markets and treasury officials to task. I called a former FIMDA official today and they said, look, it's easy to blame us, but did we know demonetization was coming? Did we know GST was coming 6 months right after that? Was there merit in the tone and tenor that Viral Acharya took, which is that treasury risk has to be managed by banks and not regulators?
Yeah. So, the first things, I was there in that FIMDA dinner, by the way.
Okay, lovely.
I heard Dr. Acharya speak live. For a minute, I was glad that I'm not in the markets anymore, given the volatility which ensued. I think there are some takeaways from Dr. Acharya's speech, and in all earnestness and in all sincerity, in the medium term, some of the points he raised, which is the need for a risk management culture, the need for proper tools to manage risk appropriately, the need to broaden the government bond market. Today, 40% of all government debt is owned by banks. The need to ensure that's broadened to retail, to maybe more FPI, maybe more institutions, maybe even corporate savings. All that is absolutely right. And the focus on that, I'm glad there's a focus on that. It won't happen overnight, but hopefully these things will happen over a period of time. From a market perspective, however, there are a bunch of dilemmas that we have to work with. One is RBI wears two hats. It's also the merchant banker to the government, which in which capacity it tries to ensure the government gets the lowest cost highest tenor borrowing possible for it to fund its fiscal deficit. On the other hand, it's also the purveyor of financial stability and risk for banks. And these two hats don't go necessarily together at all points in time. So on one hand, the RBI cancels auctions and devolves auctions and gives interest rate signals. And on the other hand, if you have RBI wearing a different hat saying, why did you buy all those bonds? It does sound a little incongruous. The lesson I won't take away from this, I don't think Dr. Acharya was saying that banks should no longer buy these bonds. I don't think that was the intent at all. It's just that the culture, which is a more medium thing, a medium term thing, and the instruments, and we definitely need more bank participation to grow the instruments of swaps, of futures, etc. That's absolutely spot on. And I'm glad this debate happened. And the good news is the government thereafter followed up and reduced the increased government borrowing program by 30,000 crores. And, there's some sanity which has come back to the markets. Hopefully, medium term, the steps that need to be taken to broaden the market, to broaden the tools will happen. For one thing, I'm hoping that even the government borrowing program is managed better. Rather than stuffing the banks with 15-year and 20-year bonds, either floating rate bonds or short-term T-bills might be the way to go for incidents like this.
All right, Ananth, thank you so much again. Appreciate you stepping by and chatting with us on an important day.